I'm here to talk a bit about this external aerodynamics using CCM Plus. This is the outline of the meeting. So I just try to introduce a little bit about what is fluid dynamics, give some basics about fluid flow and etc. Then we talk a little bit about the course. So going to the first, I hope everyone knows what is this. This is an F1 car. You know, billions of dollars are pumped into racing of these kind of cars. So for that, I'm just playing a small video from the YouTube. So this is an F1 car. So you see a lot of things there. And this is the front wing. Of course, the primary function of the front wing is a downforce, but only a small section of it is used to create the downforce. But what about the rest of the portions? I mean, do they really need to be like that? Let's see. So you see that the wake, that is the airflow coming from the front tire, it goes to the back of the car. This is called the dirty air. And this cannot be efficiently used for the aerodynamics. What the engineers in the F1 teams, they have designed is that we'll see the next. So the two peripheral portions of the front wing, they generate something called vortices. And these vortices, they take this dirty air from the front wheel and tries to push it away from the tire wake. So you can see that how the incoming air is kind of creating these vortices due to these vortex generators. So technically, left-hand side of this is called the enplaced outwash, whereas the right-hand side of this is called this Y250 vortex. This is around 250 millimeters from the center of the car. Since the dirty air from the front tire, it goes away from the vehicle, the rest of the air which is clean, that is, which is properly channelized, it is able to enter this diffuser and as well as the rear wing, and they are having this clean air to operate on. So the aerodynamics is very predictable on this diffuser and the rear wing. This is the function of the front wing. So let's see some basics about the fluids. So what is a fluid? You guys know, I mean, your professors would have taught you. So fluids are something, they deform continuously under the shear, and they do have properties like density, viscosity, temperature, pressure, etc. So I'm showing some scary equations here. Don't get scared about this. These are the governing equations of the flow. So these are basically called the conservation laws. We have some volume integral terms and the surface integral terms. So this pi over here, when it is having a value of 1, it is called this mass conservation or the continuity equation. And if it has velocity components UVW, this is called the momentum equation. And when it has the energy, so this is the energy conservation. So all the mass, momentum, and energy conservation, these three equations are summed up in this governing equation general form. So this is the basis of CFD. So this is how we model the flow that is happening in real life. So just to give some understanding of the terms, the first term having the d by dt, this is the rate of change of certain quantity. This surface integral term with the density, this is the convective flux. And with the gradients, this is the diffusive flux. And if you have something to add or to remove, we do it via source terms. This is the basic of CFD. But as such, these equations are complex and they can't be solved as a whole for the entire domain. So how do we solve these equations? Because solving the equations give us the flow pattern. So the equations are coupled and nonlinear. So you have second order differential terms. So these are nonlinear. So these equations cannot be solved for the whole domain at a single stretch. So what we do is we split the entire domain. So that is called the computational domain into small chunks. These are called control volumes. And the process is called meshing. Meshing is quite important in a CFD process because it determines the quality of your results. Then we solve the equations on these control volumes. And for this, we use some algorithms called as simple and PISO for solving this equation. So of course, we can't solve using papers anymore. We solve using computers. And this is where computational fluid dynamics comes into play. So we solve the equation and we have to understand the results. This is the aim of the CFD. So let's talk about what are the CFD packages available. So this is an image that shows briefly most popular CFD packages available. And to just enumerate them, commercially we have something like ANSYS Flow and CFX. And with Siemens, we have CCM Plus NX Flow. With the Converge, we have Converge CFD. And there are a lot of other commercial quotes available in the market. And apart from this, we do have ESI open form. And from the Stanford University, we have SU2. So these are the open source codes that are also available. So next, we try to see a like, what are the applications of CFD? So you learn CFD and where you can use them. I hope some of you guys can identify this bike. This is the Kawasaki Ninja H2R, beast of a machine, if you can call it. So while descending this Kawasaki engines, so it was decided to have a 1000cc displacement, and it had four cylinders. So they wanted to make it this ultimate motorcycle. So everyone who has this Kawasaki Ninja should be proud of it. But what happened is they had problems. So the problem was that because of this 1000cc engine, there are tremendous heat generations. So the heat was produced very much, and they had to deal with the removal of the heat. Otherwise, vehicle will fail. So they did a CFD analysis. They tried to model this Kawasaki Ninja with even a passenger sitting with the helmet. So that is the level of complexity that you can bring into the CFD packages. So then they tried out various designs and then finally found out a design that was the best suited for their own design specifications. So the heat removal was very good in this case. So this is just one example from the automotive domain. There are also a lot of other things available. So for example, you have this external aerodynamics. The purpose of the CFD is to study the drag lift forces that is acting on a vehicle. So you want to have the car move faster with better efficiency, and you have to have the better balance of the wheels. So we study the moments acting on the front and rear of the wheels. Then we have this underhood heat transfer. So this is used to study the temperature of the air. So what happens is the engine, you know this internal combustion engines, they produce heat. And this heat needs to be removed from the car. Otherwise, the efficiency reduces and sometimes the engine can fail. We study the airflow around these engines, basically using this radiators, air conditioners, etc. So the heat is being removed, and we see what is the temperature of the air exiting the engine compartment. And of course, there are some metallic and plastic parts that are available in the engine compartment. So if the temperature goes beyond certain limit, these parts will fail. So it is very essential that we study this temperature on this. Finally, we decide on this optimal cooling methods for this kind of problems. So the next comes combustion. So we study the fuel air mixing pattern, how the efficiency of the combustion has, and also we design the IC engine components using this CFD. The next kind of application is multiphase analysis. There are a lot of multiphase things available using CFD, and I'm just showing one example regarding this. This is called the water wading. So what happens is, for example, if you take the floods that happen, all over the world, and particularly in India, we have Mumbai, even Chennai got flooded in 2015. So a lot of vehicles, water entered the compartment. So what the car manufacturers, they do is they do these kind of tests. So this is the Toyota Fortuner, which goes to this water wading test in real life. So the depth of the water is 70 centimeters. So the car goes in. So the water enters the engine compartment. So it kind of wades through the water. It's kind of a swimming pool for the car. So then it finally comes out. So the water has to drain quickly out of this compartment. So what is studied in this? So as the water enters, components inside the engine compartment, they will be applied a lot of stress. So whether this stress is able to match the design specification of the components that are studied. And I'm just showing a similar simulation that was done using CFD. So whatever the reality, we try to bring it inside the computer so that the cost of the entire procedure will be reduced. So the designs are quickly given to the market. So you see the waves being formed. So as the water goes in, CFD, as I said before, it is used not only in automotive, but even in other domains. So this is aerospace. So the external aerodynamics of a flight. So again, we study the drag lift forces, whether the pressure on the components are good enough, whether the material will be able to match the stresses. And then we also study the missiles. So we have subsonic, supersonic missiles. So we need to study the flow of air around it, how efficiently this can be launched. And also we have re-entry capsules. For example, SpaceX, they are talking about reusable rockets. So the rocket goes from the Earth to the outer space, then it has to come back. So we have the re-entry capsules coming in, and we need to study the temperature analysis of this. So we design for the best possible outcomes. Then we have the heating, ventilation, and air conditioning. For example, you sit in a car or you sit in a plane, how the cooling of your passenger compartment is. So we have to optimize the airflow with the temperature inside the aircraft. So finally, every designer wants to make the passengers comfortable. And there is a special kind of analysis called this thermal comfort analysis that takes into account your clothing. So let's say you are wearing a sweater and the AC is not so much, then you will start feeling warm. So in that case, the flow of the air should be higher. And similarly, if you are wearing cotton dresses, then you might find it very cool. So we need to reduce the flow of air. So this is called the thermal comfort of the passengers. And this is also being studied using CFD. Yeah, here we talk about air acoustics. Ironically, the sound did not come. Probably some air acoustics needs to be done for here as well. So again, sound is compression and expansion of air. And air is again a fluid, so we can study the sound. So we study the nature of sound generated, and we use this mathematical technique called the Fourier transforms. When compared to other simulations, this kind of simulation, this aeroacoustics, they're very computationally intensive. So, you need to have more accuracy than other simulations because the sound variation will be in the order of the seventh decimals, and you need very good softwares and accurate things to be done. So then coming to the process industry or the oil and gas industry, you can see something called a flow assurance. You study about how the piping needs to be done, how the flow will be, whether there are any clogging in the joints happening due to the dust that comes in the pipes. All these things can be done using CFD. And again, multiphase, I showed an example for the automotive. And here also there is a multiphase that is coming in. So this is an example called the oil water separator. So the oil that is being taken, it will be sent to a separator. So as you see, the incoming mixture is oil and water completely mixed together. And due to the density differences, if you give some time, they will kind of settle down and that can be removed easily. And these tanks are used in chemical industries. So you see how the flow of the fluids happen, how the mixing happens. So we see about the separation pattern, the time for separation. Basically, all these are done to improve the efficiency of the separation. Then coming to turbo machinery, this is a whole big subject. So we have turbo machines, and this is an example of a turbocharger in your car. So you have your turbine side where energy is taken from the exhaust of the engines. Then it is used to pressurize the air that is going into the inlet. Then the applications still go on. So we use it for manufacturing. Even we study how the castings can be done. So this is an example of a centrifugal casting where the whole thing is rotated and the flow of the hot metal happens. And since hot metal is again behaving like a liquid, so we study this using CFD. Then there is something called a surface coating. So you have your cars, which is exposed to the atmosphere. So what the manufacturers do is they coat the surface of the car using good chemicals so that the life of the surface is, very good. So we need to study these kind of things as well. So basically they have something called a paint layer thickness. So how much the layer of the surface coating is being deposited. All these are studied. So finally, we talk a little bit about the course. So who should attend this course? Basically mechanical, automobile, aerospace, engineering students. So if there are anyone working in this industries, automotive, aerospace industries can also attend this. And if you are interested in learning this STAR CCM Plus, you're welcome. And what should you know before attending this course? Of course, engineering basics, fluid mechanics. And we do recommend that, you have a working STAR CCM Plus installation. We can't really help out there. I'm sure, you can contact your university persons or someone to get this thing going on. And if you know some automobile basics, like what is drag, lift, etc., those things are preferred, but not really necessary. So what will be taught? We talk about STAR CCM Plus fundamentals. So how to clean up a CAD, do the surface wrapping, the meshing and in surface and volumes. Then we also talk about what are the physics models that are needed for the external aerodynamic simulations. Then we talk about reporting the results and plotting them, and of course post-processing. So post-processing is really getting the cool images and the videos. So why should you do this course? So top automotive companies use Star Simplus as their primary safety tool. For example, Maruti Suzuki, Mahindra, Hyundai, whatever car you name it, Tata, all of them use Star Simplus as a primary safety tool. And not only automotive, even aerospace companies use Star Simplus. And as such, Star Simplus is one of the top safety tools in all the industries. And once you know this stuff, you will be standing out in the crowd and you will become readily employable. So if 100 students go into an interview and you tell that, you know, I have a Star Simplus experience, I know I have done these projects, then you will readily be, you know, employable.
Thank you.